God healing in his way. His government established. Wonderful now is his name. Oh, he's our everlasting Father. Mighty God, Prince of Peace. God healing in his feet, his government is standing, wonderful now is his name, oh he's our everlasting Father, mighty God, Prince of Peace. God healing
in his way. His government established. Wonderful now is his name.
Prince of Peace.
Facebook concerning the service, to be encouraged and to be refreshed in the Lord. How many knows we need to have a refreshing in the Lord? Sometimes this whole world can beat you down and you just need to be like a fighter. You have to go to the corner and get worked on a little bit, get patched up so you can come back out. Hopefully put a beating on the devil, Phyllis. Glory to God. My wife ain't here, so I'm going to speak for her. She's going to put a beating on the devil. Hallelujah. Speaking of Bobby Jean, she's doing good. Surviving about is what she's doing with all the things going on. A lot of drama up in Michigan, but she's, by the grace of God, she's taking care of things, and looks like she'll be home probably around March the 15th, if not sooner. If she gets too fed up with everything, she'll probably catch a plane and be here tomorrow. But anyway, we're looking at probably the 15th of March. Her birthday will be the 18th, and we want her here for that for sure. Jane, why don't you come? And Jane's got a special prayer request. I hate for you to have to do that, but yeah, walk around here. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And that way you can have the microphone and still be on camera. Well, I'll turn the camera toward you.
Oh. I love everybody.
All right.
I have a prayer request today. It's quite an urgent one. And Phyllis Smith and I have been ministering to a lady for going on maybe a couple of years now. But her I can't mention her name because it's confidential. But here is the thing. She's a spirit-filled lady, and she's in dire need. She's in a nursing home, and they are letting her out tomorrow. And she has no home. She has nowhere to go. And God can do something for the lady between now and whatever time they're letting her out tomorrow. She's a spirit-filled lady. You would all know her if I said the name, but it's confidential. I think I'll let her tell her story. When God does what he's going to do for her, I believe she might be among us and she could tell her own story. And so I'd like to have it like that. But it's just dire, she's homeless, in other words. And but they're going to let her out of that nursing home. And all I know is here's our chance. All of you out there that are the body of Christ, you know who you are. It is time for us to stretch forth our hands and heal the nations. Here's we can do it. Together. We don't know what God has planned for her life, but that's not the issue right now. The issue is the need that she's in. But I sung a song to her. I've taken the chains from off thy neck. Do you remember that? And I sang it to her, and something burst forth in her. And that was the thread that I hung on to. And I kept going back to that with her. When she would get negative, I would say, now let's get back on track. And the lady is opening up to the higher things of God. Not that I can change anybody. I can't change anybody. But there was such compassion to see this human being in this kind of need. Her home, the home that she has is not habitable. And so all of you out there, join with us, and we can stretch forth our hand, and let's see the nation begin to be healed. And we've got a mighty, mighty God. Thank you so much.
There's so many critical and crucial things that are happening to God's people. And we certainly will be lifting this woman up before the Lord. And God's got a purpose in Jane and Phyllis ministering to her. And I know that God can make a way where there seems to be no way. So we're just going to stretch our hands out right now. Father, we're just praying, God, that you are the God of miracles. You're the only one, Lord, that can help us in these type of situations. So we turn to you, our source, our hope is in you, Lord. And we're asking you, Father, that you will move for our dear sister that there will be a way made that no man can hinder. And Father, that doors will be opened to her that no man can shut. So Father, we're believing for her provision. We're believing for a place to open up for her, Lord, so that she isn't homeless. And Father, we know that you, Lord, are the one that can put someone in her pathway, Lord, that will help her in this situation, Lord. So God, we ask you, Father, that you will speak to each heart, and that God, there will be a way made for our sister. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You are the one, Lord, the only one. Hallelujah. Gary, do you remember the words to the Potter House? I went down to the Potter's house.
Most of it.
I went down. Till the spots are removed, Lord, keep the wheel turning till I look just like you, and let your love cover every fault that I see.
Just like you.
Charlotte wrote a song that pretty much says that we're closer now than we've ever been before. Page 19. And that's a fact. When you think about it, there's no sense going halfway through something and then try and go back the other half backwards. if you come this far, then you just need to understand that God's got a release for us. Suffering isn't forever in God. God only keeps us in the fire until the job of the fire is done. And it's not an ongoing fiery trials. There are some of us who are ready to walk out of our particular fire and, again, get refreshed, get relief, be encouraged, get your feet under you again, and let the ministry of the Lord minister to you and take off of you your worn, torn garments and put on fresh, new garments. Amen. And I believe that's what's happening, is that God has got his hand on the people and he is bringing us into a place where we are going to drink of clear waters. Hallelujah. Sit beside the river of the Lord and bathe our bruised body in those waters until we're made whole again. Now, God's not going to stop dealing with us until we're perfect, until, like the song said, until we look just like him. Neither is that potter going to let that clay be in an unfinished form. He is going to keep working at it until it is perfect, exactly the way the master wants it to be. So there's an ongoing dealing. But I feel like right now there's a refreshing for the people of the Lord, a relief coming for us. Praise God. And look for things to start going the other way. You know, we only go into the woods halfway. The rest, we're coming out. And we only go into the fire halfway. The rest of the time is coming out of the fire. Praise the Lord. So let's believe for each other. And let's pray for one another so that we can all gain strength this morning. I just feel such a need for that throughout the body, that we need strength in the Lord. I feel a discouragement is on some, and I don't know who I'm talking about. I just know what my spirit feels. And I pray that this morning, whatever's said and done, will be an encouragement to you, to bring you again into your joyful position in the Lord, and to bring you out from under all that weight that you're experiencing. I don't know what key this is, Gary. Let's try D. G, I think. Well, we're closer now than we've ever been before. Get on your feet, let's take a stand. We're crossing over with this old man. Perfection tones are ringing loud and clear. Off with the dross, down with our mind. A brand new nature we will find. This is the day. Did I switch keys?
I think you did.
I don't
You weren't in any of these keys.
I don't think so. You know what? We can all stand to laugh, right? And I believe that you and I were playing when this happened.
Oh, God, help us.
But this lady got up to sing. And every time she would finish the song, when she started again, she'd go half a step up.
Oh, God, yeah. Oh, yeah.
She'd start half a step up.
Oh, yeah.
And we all started looking at each other because we knew that she was going to get to the point where she wasn't going to be able to sing that song anymore.
It kept getting higher
and she
and
got
higher.
Almost into a falsetto with it.
Yeah.
Lord, don't let me go there. Hallelujah. Give me a G. Now, stay in G.
I'm asking you the same thing.
Well, we're closer now than we've ever been before. Get on your feet, let's take a stand. We're crossing over with this whole man. Perfection tones are ringing loud and clear. Off with the dross, down with our mind. A brand new nature we will find. This is the day. We're closer now than we've ever been before. Get on your feet, let's take a stand. We're crossing over with this old man. Perfection tones are ringing loud and clear. Up with the dross, down with our mind. A brand new nature we will find. This is the day where we're closer now than we've ever been before. Get on your feet, let's take a stand. We're crossing over with this whole man. Perfection tones are ringing loud and clear. Up with the dross, down with our mind. A brand new nature we will find. This is the day. This is the day. This is your day. This is your day. Where we're closer now than we've ever been before. Get on your feet, let's take a stand. We're crossing over with this old man. Perfection tones are ringing loud and clear. I can hear them. Can't thought the dross down with our mind. A brand new nature we will find. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. This is your day, says the Lord. This is your time, says the Lord. I'm going to raise you up in my sight, says your God. I'm going to make you new. I'm going to refresh your mind. I'm going to cause you to think right again about your situation. I'm going to cause you to fly like an eagle, says the Lord. I'm going to take the weight off your shoulders and give you freedom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. You're coming out and I'm going to bring you in. Hallelujah. I'm going to cause your enemies to be dispersed, says the Lord. I'm going to heal your body and your mind, and I'm going to set you free. Your time is now. You're coming out of your affliction, says the Lord, and I'm going to make you sit down in the house of your God, and you're going to learn of me. I'm going to take you a new way that you've never seen before. And you're going to walk the path I pointed out for you with joy in your heart and a song in your mouth, says the Lord. You're mine and I have chosen thee. Oh, you're not a throwaway. You're a keeper, says the Lord. I'm going to hang on to you. I'm gonna bring you all the way through, and I'm gonna set your spirit in a high place, and you're gonna rejoice in your God. Hallelujah, 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 Lord, hallelujah. Amen and amen and amen. Glory, glory, glory. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, my God, my God, my God. For such a time as this, for such a time as this, we've been summoned here by God for such a time as this. We will not be silent. We will not hold back. And by His grace, we will rise up for such a time as this. For such a time as this. For such a time as this. Everybody ought to know this. If you don't know it, I'm going to tell you. We are in a battle. Hallelujah. The enemy is arrayed against us. The enemy is going to and fro like a roaring, devouring lion. And God's people, all God's people, of course, are in a battle. But especially those who have been set aside by God for a special purpose. And the enemy is focusing his power over those people that are called apart, and we fit that category. And I was thinking this morning, and the Spirit was speaking to me, that the enemy wants to keep us silent. The enemy wants us to stop being so, what's the word for it, bold in the Lord. And he's doing everything to make us think we're not worthy of this, that we're not up to this, that God must have made a mistake and he needs to go looking for somebody else. And I have heard that in my ear in the Spirit of the Lord, people saying, Lord, you must have made a mistake because I'm telling you, I cannot do this. It's not in me to do this. I don't have enough strength to do this, Lord. And I'm not spiritual enough to do this. I'm not strong enough to do the things that you're speaking to us. And you know, all of that is valid. We're not. But since when has God started picking a people who are able? He's always chosen the unable. He's always chosen those who are too foolish, too dumb, too ignorant of the things of God. God's always chosen those who other people would say, what good can come out of that? Like they did of Jesus when they said, what good thing can come out of Nazareth? And I'm telling you, folks, that's what the enemy is wanting you to focus on. But I'm telling you, we have a word in us. We are of an order that is not to be taken lightly. And we are not to be looking for any other order than what God has called us into here. We don't know all about it enough to be scholars about it. There's so much about what God has called us into and the order that he's called us into that we're like, we're sort of like not have all of our vision yet. And we're like the man who is being healed of his eyesight and he still saw men as trees. And knowing they weren't really trees, but he couldn't see them as men yet. And there's many things about what we're doing and saying right now that we seem like as though we're that blind man that's being healed, and we're starting to see things we've never seen before, but we still don't have them in their right view yet to be really ready to expound upon them. But I'm telling you this, we are in an order regardless. And we have got to start living in that order, not just preaching it, not just talking about it. We've got to become that order. And we know that God is raising us up for that very purpose, glory to God, is that we are going to bring a word to this earth that is never, ever heard before. And there are those in this world that have known nothing about God. But I'm going to tell you something. When the ministry of this order start raising up and start voicing in the Spirit of the Lord, start speaking into the air these very things, that voice is going to go all through the earth. And those that have never known anything that men have talked to them about, they're going to hear that voice and remember it as being the voice that they know in the Father. Hallelujah. So we won't have to be holding seminars about the third day or about Feast of Tabernacles or about Melchizedek or anything else. We won't be trying to teach the nations all of our doctrines. They are going to know it by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. So get ready for God to raise you up. You have to be raised up because we need each other. Glory to God. We can't do without each other. So here we are a bunch of misfits, not able to do anything in God, and yet the Christ within us is more than able, Hakarababahaya, to deliver us out of all of our weakness, out of all of our frailty. He is able to make us mighty men and women of valor. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I was on the phone with Bobby Jean this morning and told her, I said, I need prayer, honey. I need prayer. I just, I feel empty. And I'm telling you, I feel like I'm not able. And you know, usually when you tell people I need prayer, they'll just say, okay, I'll be praying for you. Well, you don't say that to Bobby Jean. I need prayer. She bust out into this prayer for me and it made me ashamed. She was calling me a mighty man of God, the anointed of the Lord, a man of integrity and strength. And everything she was saying was opposite of what I actually was feeling. And it made me embarrassed. I'm sitting there, dead as a doornail, and she's telling me the truth. Her truth, the Lord's truth, supersedes my truth. Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Every time. I know we don't look like much, we don't act like much, but I'm telling you, God's doing some deep things right now by the Spirit of the Lord. And it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. And there is within each and every one of us something greater than what we are in our natural. And how we thank the Lord for that. Amen. I want to feed God's people so much. That is my whole desire and want in the Lord. And I sat here this morning saying that to the Lord. All I want to do, God, is feed your people. What are we feeding them? The living bread. The wine of life. Amen. So that they can rejoice in the Lord. So that they can glorify God. So that Jesus gets lifted up. Hallelujah. High and lifted up. And his train fills the temple. Glory to God. Oh, karababahaya. Oh, harandadam. Isn't that your heart's desire?
Amen.
Is to minister Christ? Hakaramahaya. Now, I'll tell you something else, and I'll get done with my preaching, and then we can sing some more, and then whoever else can preach. The Lord spoke to me to remember that our word is creative. We have a creative word. You don't have it. Christ has it within you. He is the creative word. And if we allow him to speak, we are creating a new heaven and a new earth. Glory to God. Who do you think's creating that new heaven and new earth? It's the sons. It's the ones that Christ has anointed and given that creative word unto. Hallelujah. So that as we start to speak the words of life, things are changing all around us, in us, outside of us, everywhere. Hakoramahaya. Things are changing simply because we're speaking the things of God. Hallelujah. Simply because we're lifting the Lord up in our midst, and if we will continue to lift him up, he will bring us to where he is in authority and power, exousia and dunamis, and we will be able to deliver the word of the Lord to the nations. Hakegamasandahaya. All of this suffering going on over in Turkey and Syria, all of this that is happening in even in the United States with these shootings going on and the unrest, hallelujah. We have a word, dear ones. We have a word, and we need to be speaking it into these situations so that they will be changed, hallelujah, by the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. So don't forget, you are creators. When the Spirit comes upon you and he starts speaking, Paul, I was reading about tongues. And Paul was giving instructions, maybe it was James, I can't remember. I think it was the 14th chapter. I can't remember the book. That's why I thought maybe it was James. But it was an instruction about unknown tongues and tongues with understanding. And Paul said, I would rather speak five words, I think he said, in understanding rather than 1,000 words of unknown tongues. Because when you're speaking in unknown tongues, you're speaking to God but not to men. And our job is to speak to men. He anoints us in order that we might minister to this earth. That's why we're here. We're to be the visible expression of an invisible God, as we have said many times. And that expression needs to be the expression of who God is, not who you and I are, not our titles, not our entitlements or anything else that we think that we are. It's about who God is, the Father. I love that song. He's our everlasting Father. That's who he is. And we need to be able to portray that to the people of God. This isn't just another man we're talking about. He's not the preacher. He's not the minister. It's God. Anything that we're saying this morning, it's not us. It's God coming out of us, speaking out of us, worshiping out of us. It's God. It's Christ. Hallelujah. And that word has the power to create, to form a new earth and a new heaven, a new you. Hallelujah. And to do away with your weights and those things that hinder you. How many know that we've got things that hinder us? They're always active in our life. Things that draw us away from God rather than to God. And we let a lot of things into our lives that become distractions and drainage off of us. But we're in love with those things, so we haven't cut them off yet, but we are. We're going to. We're going to start getting serious with God and start cutting off some of these things out of our everyday lives that are taking us away from our order in God. Hallelujah. I liken us under the Zadok priesthood. That was a priesthood unlike the other priests, because they didn't, they ministered to God. They had a special relationship with God, and God used them in a special way. And we are like unto that in Christ. We're not just another church or another fellowship or however else we want to put it. We are this this tribe, if you want to put it that way, of a people who have been apprehended by God, like Paul was apprehended when he was Saul, and he became Paul. So have you been apprehended, and whatever you were termed or whatever you thought of yourself before that apprehension, you are no more. Hallelujah. You're a new creature in Christ. Glory to God. So we need to start living like it. Amen. Raising up in the Lord, getting bold in the Lord. Hallelujah. Gary and I both had a mentor, Dale Davis, and one of the main traits about Dale was that he was not ashamed of God, of Christ in his life. And he worshiped the Lord like David. He worshiped the Lord with all that was within him. When he's saying to the back row. And he wasn't afraid of what people thought of him. He would get so lifted up in the Lord. Even if you didn't want to get lifted up in the Lord, you got lifted up in the Lord. He took over that whole, if it was another church he'd never even been in, he could do that. From the back seat, take over the service by the Spirit of the Lord and lift that whole congregation up into worship. We've seen it. And that's what I want for myself. I want to be that one that isn't ashamed of the Lord. Amen. Isn't ashamed to be able to praise him, hallelujah, and to worship him and to speak of him, glory to God, and to shine that light into the midst of darkness. Woo, glory to God, hallelujah. I don't know where it's at, but key of D, I believe, Gary, we are speaking a word. It's 14, number 51, 52. We are speaking a word, a new and living word, a word that knows no boundaries, a word with power to save, a word with power to heal, a word that will never pass away. Oh, hallelujah. We are speaking.
Word with power.
sing it again. Oh, we are speaking a word, new and living word, a word that knows no boundaries, a word with power to save, a word with power to heal, a word that shall never pass away. Oh, it's a word that will never pass away. Well, glory, glory. Hallelujah, 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 Lord. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Sometimes it's good to hear from somebody that's been down the road a ways. And a lot of people that are coming into this word, they have no idea what it's like to go through persecution. They think everybody ought to love them. they think that everybody ought to just enjoy what they have to say.
Yeah.
And after all, it is the good news. And you would think that everybody would love you if you're talking about good news. But amazingly, they love the bad news.
Yeah.
They want to hear about the devil having all this power over them. They're wanting to hear about all the bad things, doom and gloom, that other preachers preach about. But when you start talking about good news, you've made enemies. And if we went by our feelings in this day, we wouldn't get very far. Gary and I and others have seen the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yeah.
In God and in God's people. And you've got to learn how to preach to the ugly as well as the beautiful. When they've set their jaw against you,
yeah. And
they say, bless me if you can, well, you've got to raise to the occasion. You've got to deny yourself, and you've got to get lost in God. Folks, that is the key. Get lost in God. Oh, hallelujah. Have we forgotten that? Are we still wrestling with flesh and blood? With our feelings, trying to change flesh and blood somehow, to thinking that if we can just change that old flesh and blood, that they'll love us anyhow? We are not, that's not possible. You have to get in the Lord. You have to get lost in God and keep ministering the word, because the only one that can change that person and those persons is God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And we can't allow people to hold us back. We can't allow those that can't flow with us, that can't see what we're seeing. We can't allow that to hold us in and make us silent, to where we get discouraged and say, well, I'll just stay home and I won't do anything. We can't do that. We have to press. Some people don't even know what that is, to press in the Lord. Now, that's not to get all distraught and get in yourself and try to make a way in your flesh. Pressing in the Lord is stretching forth your hand and reaching out and grabbing hold of eternal life and not letting go, dear ones, not letting go, hallelujah, not giving up on God. Hanging on to what God has given to you. And if nobody but you believes in it, well, if nobody but you believes in it, I'd go to the Lord with it. But if the majority turns against you because of it, then you've got to hang on and be faithful and know that God is going to justify you in the end. Hallelujah. What he's doing in you will be justified by God in the end. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So be lifted up. Be encouraged. Be refreshed this morning. Hallelujah. It's not as bad as it seems to be. Amen. It looks worse than it actually is. Isn't that what some people say about blood when they... Paula used to be a paramedic, and she used to go to these car wrecks and everything, and I'm sure she found out that to be true. You get all the blood washed away. It wasn't quite as bad as what all the blood made it look. Hopefully, in most of the cases, sometimes it was. But a lot of times, it's not as bad as it actually looks. Hallelujah. That's why Paul's called it a light affliction. Amen. That's why he called it that. Praise the Lord. Amen. Were you going to say something? Oh, okay. All right, I'm done. Whoever else has a song or a word, you are free. Oh, God, Mama, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, everybody's looking at me.
Yes, I do.
Holy, the Holy
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know that song, it shall fall, it shall flow like a river, it shall fall as the rain. Desert, flow mighty river, until the desert blooms. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Flow and whithersoever that river shall run, everything will live. Oh, Karamamahaya, glory, we send you forth, O river of God. Hallelujah, Halalamahaya. We send you to the nations, glory. Amen and amen. Glory. Glory. It's amazing how many ministers are ministering and have ministered this morning. And their words are creative. James said the tongue is set on fire. The tongue has the power of hell, if so used that way. And I feel so much for the people who are sitting under that type of ministry, that their words are full of fear, torment. But I thank God that God's using the tongues of men for good, that we're speaking words of life and not death. Gukaramamahaya. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Another song that I don't know. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Come on, Phil. Phil's. Yeah, come on, Pauletta. Paul. wonderful words, beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sing them over again to me. Should have been the same key we were in.
Maybe.
Were we in D?
Yeah.
Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Wonderful words, beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Wonderful words, beautiful words, wonderful words of life. We're going to give Gary one more try. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Wonderful words, beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Wonderful words, beautiful words, wonderful words of life. That's how I feel this morning. I feel like God's speaking loving words to us. Beautiful words. Sarah, ukaramashandahaya. God has a beautiful word in you and for others. Hallelujah. It's not by chance that your countenance is so beautiful. It's because you have a beautiful spirit. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Okay, Gary.
That's it. I can't keep covering for you. Good, because I'm tired of you making up songs. It's interesting, how the Lord speaks to the body basically the same word, and they bear witness. And this week, all week long, the Lord has put in my spirit that same verse that Bob's already began to quote earlier about being apprehended. And some of the things that I want to share just for a moment, if I can. By the way, let me bring that up real quick. That's found in Philippians 3, 12, 13, 14. And it's a powerful word. The Lord has been dealing with me here lately anyway about being apprehended for something. And the thing the Lord began to quicken to me, and I want to share it if I can. This makes sense. Paula jumps on me about that, saying that. But sometimes what I'm saying don't make any sense to me, so I'm figuring, how could it make sense to anybody? But I was thinking of how that, and Bob already brought it out. The Apostle Paul was apprehended, or another word is arrested, on the road to Damascus. And the Lord has been dealing with me that, and Bob brought it out already really, really clear and good. There's a group of people that have been apprehended, arrested, okay? The Lord's quickened to me how in the book of the Song of Solomon, everybody loves that. It's a love book, and we've got all these really flowery things we say about it. But there's three different levels. There's three different groups, if you please, or whatever you want to call it, in that book. You have the groom, and you have the bride, and then you have what they call the bridal company. And those that study the book, you'll see the difference. The bridal company enjoys the atmosphere. They enjoy what is taking place, but they are not invited into the bedchamber. This is what God is doing with those that are arrested. And I got into a study of this just early this morning, a little deeper, as it were. The Apostle Paul called himself a prisoner of the Lord. And he also referred to himself as an apostle. So I got to wondering about that. He had called himself a prisoner just five times, but he called himself an apostle over a dozen times. And I couldn't figure out, and I mean, you can get into the definition of those things, and it's okay. But the Lord began to quicken something to me in this area here. He was a prisoner, which actually in the Greek means to be bound in marriage, bound for a unity, or you're bound up. That's the base word for that word in the Greek, as opposed to the word apostle. And the Lord and the Apostle Paul said, I'm a prisoner five times. He only said that five times. Why? Because it was a relationship that God had established in him aside from and different from being an apostle. And the Lord began to quicken this to me for a reason. We have been arrested, and I wanted to read this to you, and I know we know this already. It's in Philippians 3. The Apostle Paul said, and he said, not as though I had already attained, that word attained, another word for it's apprehended, or either were already mature or perfect. But I follow after that if I may apprehend that for which I'm also apprehended of Christ Jesus. And this is the thing that God quickened to me. Being apprehended for something or arrested for something and attaining the fullness of that thing are two different things. And we think when the process is drawn out that we've not been apprehended, but we have been arrested. I've got some different commentaries on this thing, and I really got into it. It really, Bob, ministered to my spirit how that we in this, I don't know how to say this any other way. We're in this word as opposed to a denominational thing. God has separated, arrested us, pulled us out, and we've been arrested to the point that we don't understand the depth of being arrested. When he said, I'm a prisoner, that means our life is not our own. We do not do what we want to do. The matter of fact, I think the Apostle Paul even said that. He said, those things that I want to do, I can't do anymore. And the things I don't want to do, I'm doing. Right. And I tell Paul all the time, I'm retiring. I'm done. And it don't work out, Bob. It just don't work out. Yeah. And he said, I've been arrested for a purpose. And you know, the thing that quickened in my spirit was this. The Apostle Paul made the statement. He said, I've been given a thorn in the flesh, lest I be exalted above measure for the revelation that God has given us. And that thorn in the flesh, now I know the scholars all gathered around that, and they're trying to figure out. It was his eyesight. It was this. It was that. It was some kind of ailment. It was involved there. And may or may not have been. I could care less. But I thought to myself how we have been arrested and we've been given a thorn in the flesh. It may not be our health. It may not be our finances or our jobs or our relationships or whatever. Sometimes it's all kinds of stuff that thorn in the flesh is there to make us understand we haven't arrived to that place yet. Now, I don't know if this makes any sense or not, but here's what I'm hearing the Lord say. I've apprehended you like I did Paul. And Paul said, I've not yet reached why I've been apprehended. I've not reached the why of it yet. I just know that I have, and I know it ain't here yet. Yeah, it's one of those things. I don't know what the definition is, but I'll know it when I see it. And that's kind of what's going on with some of us, is that we've been apprehended, arrested for a divine purpose, and we find ourselves wanting to go this direction, and God says, no, you're going this direction. Yeah, but it don't make any sense to go this direction. It don't make any sense what God has arrested us for. But it's becoming clear how the Apostle Paul, just like the Apostle Paul said, you know, one of the things I think Bob and Charlotte wrote a song a long time ago, there's one thing greater than faith, and that's purpose. And the Lord began to quicken this to me, how that we have been apprehended for a purpose. And as the Lord began to quicken this in my spirit, I begin to look about how that all through the scriptures, all through from A to Z, everything there is about purpose. When you look at how that Moses was raised with the best education in the most royal surroundings, but the purpose of God, he had been apprehended for a different purpose. And we look at, and I can go through all the scriptures today, how that we can go through David, and we can go through Solomon, and we can go through Paul. And I've thought to myself, Paul, and no doubt some of us, as I look around the room today, and no doubt those that are watching, we have sat like the Apostle Paul at the feet of Gamaliel, and we've learned the correct pronunciation of things, and we know the Bible, we know how to quote Scripture, we know what our background denominational hang-ups may or may not have been. We know these things, and so we figure we're going to help God, not realizing that he's getting ready to arrest us. And I've shared this before. I think I probably shared it last week on an evening in Paris there, Heaven's on Fire. But I can speak only for myself how I was raised old Pentecost. But I figured by the time I was 18, 19 years old, I'd had enough church for the whole county. And I really didn't need to go anymore. But my mother insisted that we go. She was one of them things. She bugged us all the time. And I was a young married thing. And I was about to carnal as, Bob. So I didn't want to go. She kept on. So we decided to go one morning. And I'll never forget, it's a little Assembly of God church. That's where we had grown up and everything, little country church out there. And I don't know, there's probably 70, 80 people there that day. And me and my cousins were sitting on the back row while our wives and kids were up on the second or third row with our mothers. My aunt, which is my mother's sisters, they were all there. And we're all in the back row, a bunch of hooligans, if you please. And all we could think of is hurry up and get it over with so we can go do what we do. And I'm 19 or so years old at this point, 18, 19, 20, somewhere along in there. And I'll never forget, we're standing up to be dismissed, to be dismissed. And I've never forgotten this. The pastor gets up and he says, we're going to dismiss, but for some reason, I feel to give an altar call. And me and my cousin going, oh, crud. Now we got to do, and everybody in the church basically was saved as far as I was concerned, and it was a waste of time. So every head bowed, every eye closed, everybody's been to Pentecostal church, that's the routine. And here they are, we're all doing this, and we're standing on the back row, me and my cousin, we're standing back there, and we're going, okay, get this over with, come on, and we're doing this little number, and all of a sudden, here comes my aunt. Now, here's the routine. The way it works is this. If my aunt, his mother, if she comes back, she's after him. If my mother comes back, she's after me. We know that's the way it works in those churches. So I'm standing there, and I'm closer to the aisle than he is, and here she comes, and I went, it's you, buddy. So here she comes. She's just a-crying. And she comes back, and I scoot all the way forward against the pew that we're standing there so she can get behind me because I know where she's going. Sure enough, she went to him. And all he could say is, nope, I ain't going to, no, sorry, Mom, I ain't doing it. No big deal. She's just a-crying. And I'm going, oh, thank God, Well, she goes behind me, and when she does, all she does is put her hands on my shoulders. And I busted out squalling and bawling like somebody beat me with a trace chain. And tears, I can't hardly breathe. I'm crying so hard. And in my mind, I'm thinking, what's wrong with you? You're not hurting. You're not sad. You're not blue. There's no reason to be crying. What in the world is wrong with you? And she goes, would you like to go to the altar? And I went, no. I never forget that. I'm going no, but my head's going yes. And so she goes, come on. And I start slowly moving out to the aisle. I'm thinking, what are you doing? What are you doing? See, that's the way it works when you're arrested. You go because you don't want to go. You have no say in the matter. If you've ever been arrested in law enforcement in our world, that's the way it works. Ask Bob. He's got a wanted poster down at the post office. Anyway, I made it out to the aisle, and I'd always seen and heard growing up in Pentecostal churches about people running to the altar. I'd never done it. That day, I broke into a dead run. Could not get down there quick enough. And all the time I'm down there, I'm going, what are you doing? My mind is not here. I want to go home. But God arrested me that day and turned me around. And I got to be honest with you. There's so much I do not know or understand. But that day I know my life turned around. Because He did something I had no control over. And this is what God is doing. He said, now get this. He's arrested me, but I still don't know the purpose. See, the purpose is yet to come. And all through the scriptures, the Apostle Paul, who sat at the feet of Gamaliel, he sat there. And he knew what he knew about what God had spoke to Moses and all the prophets. He knew that stuff. He was taught. And yet he's trying to kill and arrest people that are following this man called Jesus. And then we know that on the road to Damascus, God arrested him, turned his life around. And you know, he was blinded. 3 days later, he gets his sight restored to him. And God tells him, you're going to Rome and stand before the emperor. Now, that sounds like a great word. That sounds like if God were to tell some of us, you're going to go to Washington, D.C. and stand before the president. You're thinking, praise God. You don't know you'll be a criminal when you get there. You don't know you'll be in chains. You don't know these things. Why? Because I'm a prisoner. His relationship with me is leading me to my purpose, which is to be an apostle, if you please, and I'm not after titles. I'm talking about to deliver something specific. We don't understand. The anointing on us doesn't change our lives. It empowers us to accomplish what God wants. It's the prisoner relationship that changes our nature, that changes our relationship and pulls us into the bedchamber. I don't know if this is making any sense or not, but right now God's in the process, ladies and gentlemen, of taking a select ones. Who are these people? They're the ones He's arrested. He said, you're my prisoner. Oh, my God. And here's the thing. The Bible talks about three different, the word slave in the Bible is three different definitions. First of all, there's a slave that you've been conquered. He invades your land. He steals your stuff. You're led away in chains. And your life depends on being a slave for Him. That's the slave. Then the next slave, or the next kind of slave, you've been sold into slavery. Back in those days, to settle debts, they would sell themselves or their children into slavery to pay a debt. And the final one is a love slave. You were not bound by any decree. You were not bound by debt. You are bound by love only. We have been the first kind of slave because He's invaded our land. He's arrested us and we don't like it, but we're there anyway because He's taken our stuff. He's taken our dreams, our hopes, our desires. He's taken everything away from us and we become that slave. And then we don't understand that the next thing He does is that we become paying a debt and we're trying to get out of this love, this slave relationship. We're trying to get out of it because we're paying a debt and we don't realize that in the process, He is going to turn us because of that relationship, that prisoner, as He pulls us into His bedchamber. And, oh God.
and overwhelms us with love, that we become a love slave. Suddenly we don't want to leave. Suddenly we don't want to go somewhere. Suddenly we want to have a oneness with our Father so that we're able to minister the very likeness of God. This is where we are right now. He said, the Apostle Paul said, I've not yet apprehended that for which I'm apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting, like Bob said, forgetting those things that were behind. You might have been a Saul. You might have been a whatever. But now, he said, you become a different one. I've changed your nature. I've changed everything about you because I've arrested you and pulled you into my bedchamber, and I've changed your understanding. I've changed everything about you. Oh, my God. I don't know if this makes any sense or not, but I'm telling you what, God is beginning to speak a word. He said, I'm pulling you in to change everything about you. Oh, hallelujah. I'm changing your nature. I'm changing your song. I'm giving you a new song. You're not singing this song around the rivers of Babylon while your harp is on the willow tree. Hallelujah. I'm giving you a song of deliverance. I'm giving you a song of joy. I'm giving you a song of worship and of praise. Just like that song we were singing just a minute ago. I saw the Lord. He was high and lifted up, Isaiah said. And his train filled the temple. And he said, I looked in the seraphims that were flying. One said to another, hallelujah, with two they covered their face, with two they covered their feet, and with two they did fly. And they said one to another, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And the doorposts begin to move and to shake. It's time that we had our doorposts shaking so that he can change us out of the old into the new. Oh, hallelujah. My God, in the next few verses of Isaiah 6 says, and they said, who will go for us? And I said, you can't send me, for I'm a man of unclean lips. And I'm from a people that are unclean. But then he said, the seraphim flew down off of the altar of God and took a live coal, and he touched my mouth, and it changed everything about me. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And because of that live coal that came off the altar of God, suddenly it's no longer woe is me. Now it's here am I, send me. Oh, hallelujah. And the Bible said they begin to, and here's the thing, this is where we are. This is where we are in the book of Isaiah, 6th chapter. He said, you go out, and we've heard this in years gone by. He said, you go out and you tell them, hear the word of the Lord. I'm going to speak the word, but hear not. I'm going to close your eyes so you can't see. I'm going to close your hearing so you can't hear. I'm going to close your heart so you don't understand. And I said, Lord, how long shall this thing be? He said, until there be a returning, hallelujah, of a remnant seed, and the seed, this life of God will be within them as a teal and an oak tree. They shall return and declare a brand new word. This is where we are now, ladies and gentlemen. God said, there's a tenth of you. There's a remnant seed I preserved in the earth, and I've covered you until now, and now you will begin to arise with healing in our wings, bringing deliverance, breaking the shackles, breaking the chains. Oh, hallelujah. Not with our words to cause them to understand or believe like us, but it'll go beyond their understanding and change them from the inside out into the very nature of God.
Amen.
Wow. I don't know that I meant to get all crazy there, but I tell you what, there's something happening, Bob. There's something that's seriously happening right now. Hallelujah. Oh, when we see the Lord, that he's changing us. We've been apprehended for a purpose. The Apostle Paul said, forgetting those things which are behind, I press towards the mark. And we don't understand. What's the prize? What's the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus? It's not that we glow in the dark and walk on water and walk through walls. My God, it's a manifested sonship, is that we show forth the nature of our Father. I mean, every single day, not just in service, but every single day when we wake up and open our eyes, the glory emanates out of us. Not because we say so, because others bear witness. Oh, hallelujah. And this is what God's doing with a people in this hour. He's raising you up, changing your nature. How does he change it? The Apostle Paul said, I've been apprehended for something, but I'm not there yet. It's that process between being arrested and apprehended and attaining the fullness of it, which we read in that first verse. Wow. I don't know if this made any sense, but I'm telling you what, God's doing something powerful. He is doing something powerful right now with the people. Oh, hallelujah. I'm done.
Hallelujah. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Ain't anything worse than to have somebody talking when you're having a video and nobody on screen. We get all the people complain about that. I said, can't see you, can't see you.
I can't, it's really good to see now because the wire fell out. I think you're off camera.
You are. Let me get you. There goes that little slot.
Yes.
I heard it.
There you go, you're back.
Okay.
It's not sure. He's trying to fall out.
Hello, I'm back. Gary pulled the plug on me, but that's all right. I preached about persecution, and I'll go on. I've seen them unplug preachers. Yeah, preachers be up there preaching, and they'll go up there and pull the plug on their microphone. I've seen that more than once. Oh, hallelujah. What a day. What a day it is. And aren't you glad to be alive in God? Hallelujah. And if you want to hear more of Gary, I'll tell you, you need to tune in on Tuesday evening, 7 p.m. Central Time, an evening in Paris, Tennessee. Heaven's on fire. So be sure to tune in to him on that night. Darren, we're having an Easter meeting. Hope you've already heard about it. 7th, 8th, and 9th of April. And we're looking forward to it. I say I'm looking forward to it. I'm getting a little nervous about it. I don't know if I can fit everybody in my house here. And if not, I've got to hustle and find a room. But I think we can, even if we put them down the basement, we can get everybody in here. And as the Spirit moves, you can come up the stairs and enter into the heavens. Amen. But that's April the 7th, 8th, and 9th. Now, we have an event post for it on our Facebook page. And so if you see her coming, be sure to put on there that you are going to attend. Because that will help us with food. It will help us to know about the amount of people to fit into the room here. So that's April 7th, 8th, and 9th. I do need Darren's dates if you guys have got that. It'll be Memorial Day weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, the end of May. May the 26th, 27th, and 28th. That's the church, Darren and Dana Best, in Mooresboro, North Carolina. So go to the church on web on Facebook to see more information about those meetings. And then Gary and Paula are going to be having their July the 4th weekend meeting again this year. And Bobby Jean and I are planning on attending both of these meetings. We want to support and be with those that are having these meetings. And so that will be June the 30th, July 1st, and July 2nd, right? And contact Gary and Paula and let them know if you're coming. I'd love to see y'all in these meetings. It's wonderful to be able to have this technology, and I thank God for it every day, to be able to reach, because we can reach the whole world through the internet, and that's such a blessing. But we hear people testify all the time, and we can testify to it ourselves, that there's nothing like being there in the meeting when it's happening. And we hear it all the time from people that attend. So if God directs, be sure to make a way to come. You'll not regret it. You will be blessed. Don't know if I have any other announcements. In the reading room, as I announced last Sunday, that I'm just going to let the Lord lead in it. Well, it turned out Monday was my good day, so I had in the reading room, but it was at 4 o'clock. And that's just the way my body is right now. If I don't hit it when it's able to, then I've got to say, can't do it. And it's terrible, but that's the way it is. I'm going to go see a surgeon Friday, and I can't play the guitar the way my hands are right now. So he's going to do a metacarpal tunnel surgery on my hand. And the reason why I'm having that is so that I can play the guitar again. So be holding with me on that, that will do the trick. We don't know that it will entirely, but I'm believing that it will. Amen. So be remembering me on that. I'll let you know when the date's set for the surgery itself. Anybody else have any announcements to make? All right. Father, we thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We give you the glory and the praise and the honor. Such an honor to enter into your throne room, Lord, and to be blessed like this. We pray that the words and the songs that have been sung will go unto all your people, whoever views it, and that it'll bring forth your life, Lord. We pray for your provision for each ministry, every minister that's ministering life. Oh God, I'm asking that you will provide for each one, and that you will not let their meal barrel run dry. Keep their flask filled with wine, Lord, their every provision, and we thank you for it because you are our provision, Lord. Thank you for it. Now bless each and every one as they go their way, Lord, and let them bask in this word. Let this word keep working in us that we have heard today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. All right, God bless you. We love you.